name's Julie McManus, and I'm the chair of this committee, as well as Councillor Fitz and St James, one of Birkenhead. We have apologies for absence from Councillor Jerry Annis and David Burgess Joyce, as well as the place, thank you, David, and Tracy Pilgrim, and we've got Councillor Ian Lewis, thank you. Have got any apologies from anyone else, then we'll move on. If I can thank everybody for coming this evening, very welcoming members, but equally welcoming members of the public. And it's nice to see you all here. What I would say though is, although this is an open meeting, that doesn't necessarily mean it's a public meeting. So I'd please ask you to observe that and listen to what's being said. Thank you for coming along. Tonight we've only got one item on the agenda, and we've got Bell Pickup, Carol Dean's going to do the presentation, and Andrew Gibson. What I would say before we start is, to perhaps both of you really, that the role of scrutiny is critical to public trust and confidence, especially in times of uncertainty and significant change. So I wondered why we haven't had a report prior to this meeting so that the scrutiny committee can have a look at it before we sit here tonight, and wondered if there was a reason for that. It is normal practice that the committee would receive reports prior to our meeting, and therefore this can make scrutiny quite difficult tonight. And we may have to have another meeting. I am also aware that you're keen to get away for 7:30. Well, let's see how we go. Okay, thank you. If I can ask, Mel, I believe it's yourself first off, so if you can come present the report, please, thank you. Sorry, do we have any declarations of interest?
Thank you, Chair. I'm a delegate appointed by the Council for the CWPNHS Foundation Trust.
Thank you for that. Anybody else? Thank you.
Constructed the partnership in Cheshire and Mersey. What you will come to appreciate is that all of us who are engaged in this enormous challenge around trying to transform the NHS, we are doing so whilst we are doing other jobs of running the services that are currently under enormous strain in meeting the inexorable demand placed on us by our ageing populations. So, just by way of background of why we are here and what we are about, you will be aware that in 2014, late 2014, there was a publication by the leader of the NHS, Simon Stevens, called the 5-Year Forward View. And the 5-Year Forward View talks about a whole range of things. But the one I want to focus on in relation to what I think is perhaps most important to you is the issue of integration of care. So what the 5-Year Forward View talked about in that regard was integration of primary and secondary care, that's the services provided out of hospital by your GPs and practice nurses and community staff, integration of physical and mental health, so a recognition that the NHS, for all the good things that it has always done and continues to do, it has not really addressed the issue of parity in regard to mental health, and the integration of that with physical health to look at the whole person, and the integration of health and social care, because too often, too many people were falling between the cracks, between handovers of care and social care provided by, as we have traditionally configured services, in a very siloed approach. So against that backdrop, the 5-Year Forward View talked about a future where that would look and feel very different. And then there was this pause, really, whilst the NHS responded to that. And that response came with some encouragement in the shape of NSTP, a Sustainability and Transformation Plan, configured around natural geographies or conurbations of populations, and there are 44 of those up and down the country. We happen to be one that encompasses a very large geographical area. That's Cheshire and Merseyside. Can you hear? Can you hear me? Okay. And so in that configuration, there are 2.5 million people. There are a number of organisations engaged in the delivery, the planning and delivery of health and social care. There are commissioners, there are local authorities, all of which make up.
Chair, can I just interrupt? As far as I'm aware,
Tony,
we have not been involved in anything to do with an STP.
Tony. Can we just wait till the end of the presentation, and then we'll
then
question.
So this was back in 2015, and there was a requirement for STPs, as they were called then, to deliver a plan. And that was in pretty short order, because there was a recognition that the system of care delivery and the funding associated with it was under extreme pressure. There was a real urgent need to do something quickly. And in that response, we didn't pay sufficient attention to the point that the gentleman makes about engaging with partners in local authorities and with our populations. And so we put a plan in train that was fundamentally flawed. And in recognition of that, back in the late summer of last year, we paused and we stepped back. And we said, this is not ever really going to work unless we engage with our local populations and our local boroughs, councillors, representatives to determine what the future configuration of services needs to look like. And so we took a pause and we determined that we would reset the whole programme across Cheshire and Merseyside in a very different way. So what I want to talk to you about now is the fundamental difference that we have engaged in developing and will continue to engage in developing that gives you some assurance that it is and should feel like a very, very different approach. So this is the structure of our programme and it will look fairly complicated, which is why I'm going to talk through it. And the area I want to concentrate on in the first instance is the column on the left called place-based care systems. Because if you were familiar at all with the structure of the programme as it was originally defined back in 2016, that will not have been there. That wasn't there. And I think that's where we went wrong. And so in recognition of that, what we present you to with you today is a programme that recognises that for 80% of the activity as it relates to the population in relation to health and social care, everything that happens to those individuals will happen at the level of the place. I want to talk about what a place, what we believe a place is and looks like. In the middle of the panel there, the slide that you see there, there are four key strategic work streams. And these are areas that are a constant pressure and challenge to us as an NHS that we are required to look at and to transform in order to make them sustainable and effective. So the first area is about acute care and the provision of very specialised services for relatively small numbers of people and how we configure those to meet the expectations of you as potential patients or carers or just members of the public, how we meet the expectations of people like the Care Quality Commission in order to maintain the right standards in the delivery of those services, how we maintain those services open, ready to respond to people's needs on a 24/7 basis. And that is becoming increasingly difficult to do. And primarily it's becoming increasingly difficult to do because we have real difficulties in recruiting sufficient staff to be able to do that robustly and sustainably. The second area is about mental health and learning disabilities. So this is in recognition of the specific emphasis that was placed on the need to improve the provision of mental health and learning disability services that was written about in the 5-year full review and has been welcomed, enormously welcomed, by that particular group of clients and patients and the professionals who are committed to dealing with those individuals. The third area is one that we call Carter at Scale. It's named after a gentleman who reviewed the opportunities to consolidate some of the services that are not front-facing services necessarily. They don't interact with patients in a clinical sense, but they are necessary services to maintain clinical services. So things that perhaps you might recognise with, if I say, administrative functions, certain procurement and supply functions, the logistics that go with maintaining an NHS, but you as a consumer of that service will not necessarily see or experience directly, but you need to know that that service is there and is effective and efficient and is good value for money. So that particular work stream is concerned with the opportunity for individual organisations to collaborate on certain functions that support the delivery of clinical care. The fourth one is about prevention at scale. Now, I just read your 20 pledges over there, and the sector that talks about people talks about people living longer, independent lives. Those individuals with disabilities living more independently. Now, this agenda around prevention is about the encouragement of people to live longer, healthier, and more independent lives. That's put simply, what interventions can we do at scale to support places to engender the view amongst the people who live in those places that they take some responsibility for the choices that they make, that we keep them well, that we screen them early to diagnose conditions and treat them quickly, so that access is there, so we support them, not just when they have physical manifestations of conditions that might take them to their GP, but if they are just feeling unwell or if they are isolated and lonely and may, as a utilise services that aren't necessarily appropriate for them, but they just happen at the moment to be the only services that are there. And then the third column is more about the operationalisation of the whole of Cheshire and Mersey to make sure that we are able to maintain good quality, sustainable, safe and effective services for the populations that we serve. So I don't propose to go into those in detail, but just to choose one of them, for example, the Diabetes Network, that's led by Dr. Sarah O'Brien, who is an accounting officer of a CCG within our patch, who happens also to be a nurse and a specialist in diabetes. And because she has that personal passion about the care provided for diabetic patients and sees the opportunity, if there are the appropriate interventions in good time, so that those individuals' health does not deteriorate and they don't become debilitated, there is a much, much better way for us to look after those individuals so that they can remain healthy, independent, and enjoy their lives. And then at the bottom is a box that is quite trite in terms of communications, public and partner engagement. And this again is an area that we have paid insufficient attention to. And that is why we are committing to come to events like these and others to share with you where we are up to in our thinking about the programme and to invite you to understand where and to think about where you as representatives of your communities might want to get involved and influence the shape and design of the services. So let me just talk about the place element. Now we're constructed in Cheshire and Merseyside of nine places, nine discrete boroughs, local authorities. And those nine places now have, because we have asked for someone to volunteer to be the person who is leading the process of putting place and integrated services in the places together. And so you will see for each of our nine boroughs there, St Helens, Knowsley, Warrington, Liverpool, East Cheshire, West Cheshire, Holland, Sefton, and here in the world. And Simon Banks is sat over there as your lead for this place. The place people, the agenda of place, is all about the things in that left-hand box. How do we provide better out-of-hospital care? How do we support the development of primary care, a sector that is under immense problems and stresses and strains? I'm sure it is the case that if you are like most individuals, you will struggle at times to get GP appointments. That's indicative of the fact that GPs are inundated with patients wishing to see them, and there are large numbers of vacancies and problems in recruiting GPs at a national level. So we have to do something about the delivery of primary care. Place-based care and models of facilitation and support. That's about how we support you as a place to devise the model that is going to be right for this place. And I'll come on to talk about a little bit how that's going forward. But Simon, of course, is the expert as the lead officer for this. And some of the documentation, a bit about documentation, that relates to there being a need to put in place certain governance arrangements that we would seek only really to want to do once for the whole of Cheshire and Merseyside. Because as places evolve and they require, Chair would quite rightly say, we want more to report, if you were running a place, you would want the assurance that you have governance processes in place and that there are proper accountabilities. And so if we can help places, all nine of them, instead of doing it nine times, just to do it once, that's a much more effective and efficient way of addressing the issue of governance of place. So let me just tell you a little bit about Wirral, the place. Steve, do you want to talk
about
this?
No, I'll come to it, yeah. Okay.
Give you a break. Yes, I will do. So I'm Simon Banks, I'm the Chief Officer of NHS Wirral CCG, and you'll also have noticed from the other slides I've also got a lead on women's and children's services across Cheshire and Merseyside, another thing I volunteered for about 3 or 4 years ago. I volunteered in terms of place because we're doing a lot of the integration work already. We're well advanced in terms of healthcare records, in terms of integrating the delivery of health and care across Wirral. The council already took a decision some time ago to integrate health and care teams with community trust around community hubs. And with wanting to work around the idea of community, around hospital-based, out-of-hospital models of care that involve delivering care closer to home, working with people more clearly about their self-care and how we can help them stay well for longer, to keep them out of hospital, because to steal a phrase from a colleague in Devon, there's no bed like your own bed. The best place for you to be is in your own home, and we want to keep you out of hospital as long as possible and healthy for as long as possible. We need to develop our primary care in its wider sense to do that. So there's a lot of investment currently going into additional general practice appointments. I presented to Ovian scrutiny in private briefing, but also in terms of open meetings about integration, about place, about the need to address some of the issues about raised expectations, but also in some areas of our borough, raising expectations about the services that you should have access to, about the pressures on us in terms of workforce and also in terms of finance. And it's our job, I think, to take forward 5-year forward view, but to do it in a very fundamentally different way. Because as Mel said, the system got it wrong in terms of where we were 2 years ago. Wirral Place, therefore, is about localities and neighbourhoods. The next slide I'll come on to you provides a little more granularity around that. But in common with the delivery of other services, we've focused our localities around the constituencies. around Birkenhead, South Wirral, Wallasey and West Wirral. What we learned over the last 12 months and beyond was actually the power of those constituency boundaries, of the particular needs of those areas, how people coalesce around those areas. And therefore that's how we are organising many of our services that will wrap around GP practices. There will still be 51 GP practices across Cheshire, across Wirral. There will still be those 51 practices on a contract with NHS England to provide general practice services. What we're asking them to do is work more closely with people such as Wirral Hospitals, Community Trust, Cheshire Wirral Partnership and Social Care to start to bring some of those services closer to people and to use the idea of the locality to make that happen. We've worked with public health colleagues and business intelligence colleagues to produce neighbourhood model, which, if you note, takes forward the Birkenhead, South Wirral, Wallasey, West Wirral split to a more granular level. Coming in the name Birkenhead A and B, South Wirral A and B, but really starting to reflect this in natural communities there based on economic and social identification, boundaries and so on. The idea is to push as many services into those areas as possible where it is clinically appropriate to do so, where there's the workforce to do so, but also to encourage interventions at that level. By working more in an integrated way with the local authority in terms of our commissioning of those services and with our partners and the providers in terms of the delivery of those services, we believe that we can actually improve the delivery of services, improve outcomes for people and empower people to have more of a say in their own care. Because the most important person in the journey of the care is the individual who's participating in that care. And I use the word participating because the whole purpose of this is to go away from people being recipients of care and passive in that process. And many of the work we're doing around diabetes, around respiratory services, around maternity services is about personalisation, choice and tailoring pathways. So I'm going to hand on to Mel in terms of structure now.
I just want to describe our executive chair, Andrew Gibson, his name to the plate. And there are a number of other people who are supporting the delivery of what we hope to achieve through this health and social care partnership. But I want to stress that this isn't some big machinery, it's not some big bureaucratic machinery. It is a very, very small team of individuals, many of whom are working on a part-time basis because in their other lives they are running organisations, running commissioning units, or in some instances running local authorities. So we have volunteers who have stepped up to the plate to lead on the work streams that I have described to you, supported by our small executive team, which is made up of Andrew and myself, and we have four other people who are now working on a full-time basis, just four people. An implementation director, a portfolio director who is supporting the senior responsible leads for each of the work streams, a director of communications and engagement who has been provided to us by NHS England, the centre, and a director of finance. And the clinical lead for our partnership is Dr. Kieran Murphy, who is also the regional medical director for Cheshire and Mersey and NHS England. And he is doing this in support of us, as well as his substantive role. And the relationships that you see underneath those are the critical relationships who we will have dialogue about the plans for the future. In terms of the governance there, first thing to say is, we are not a statutory body. We have no powers in statute. We have, in that sense, no legitimacy. We are reporting to NHS England, who are the regulators alongside NHS Improvement of the whole of the NHS, be that commissioning or the provision of services. And in many respects, you might say, well, that leaves you in an imbalanced position. I actually believe that where we are now, we can capitalise on it on being a real strength. Because the strength comes from the fact that the people who are working with us and supporting us to develop and deliver this vision are doing it because they really, really want to do it. And they see a real urgency in so doing. So our executive team meets every 2 weeks, and we are then reporting to our system management board. And the thing about the system management board that I want to impress upon you this evening is that it is made up of representatives of the wider system. And we have specifically invited people to represent constituencies. And those constituencies are commissioners, providers, and local authorities. So in our system management board, we have 3 seats for commissioners. We have, and it's probably worth saying that those 3 individuals represent 12 clinical commissioning groups. We have 3 seats for providers, and in order to get good representation, we've stipulated that one of those provider representatives should be a chief executive of an acute hospital. One should be the chief executive of a mental health and community provider. And the third must be a GP representing GPs across Cheshire and Merseyside. And then the final constituency is local authority colleagues. Now, I've already said we have 9 boroughs, and we have 3 representatives of local authorities who are local authority chief officers who are sat on our system management board. The system management board then reports to, the executive team meets with the wider programme leads, so that very first slide that you have that has all the work streams, we meet with the leaders of those programmes formally every 3 months. And then every 6 months we have what's called the partnership meeting, to which chief executives and the chairs of all our constituent organisations, be they local authorities, commissioners, providers, representatives of the third sector and others, including the regulators, meet all together. Now, because we have such a very big patch and a lot of constituent organisations, that's a very, very big meeting. There can be probably about 150 people in that room, but it's a very important and necessary meeting because each of those 150 people have a stake, a legitimate stake in what we are trying to achieve here. And that just, I won't go through that, and I'm conscious you have copies of this and you want to have plenty of time for questions, but that is a guide to the kinds of discussions and the responsibilities that we're taking on in each of those governance arenas. So I will end there, Chair, and if I may, perhaps go back to my seat and take questions.
Before I take questions, can I just roll back a little bit, please, about mentioned that you
you as an organisation were committing to come to events like this. I think I need to remind our NHS colleagues that this isn't an event, this is scrutiny, and you have an obligation to bring changes, significant changes such as this, to scrutiny. And I think that you misunderstand that that's the message. And I'm now going to take questions.
Could I just respond to that? So I do apologise. I'm very well aware of the role of this committee and the importance of that and our obligations in that regard. I think what I would like to stress, however, is that going forward, I genuinely hope that we don't only ever meet in this arena to have discussions about what we want to achieve across Cheshire and Merseyside, and in particular about rural players. And I think it's a recognition that we have not done enough of that outside this sort of arena, and we need to do more of it.
Thank you very much for your presentation. I have to say that I completely agree with the Chair insofar as it would be very unusual for us to take a report on a subject as big as this, with the complexities of this, without a written report submitted to us in advance. And although your presentation, I'm sure you've made it as comprehensive as possible, I don't think it will suffice for us in terms of our proper role of scrutiny. So that's just a comment. I think we probably will need to look at this in much more detail, accompanied by a written report that we can take away and look at and have it with what we want to talk to you about. You said at the beginning that one of the things you think that went wrong with the STP was that it was done badly because it didn't include place in the right place. I have to say that may well have been something that was wrong with it, but the main thing that was wrong with it, from our point of view, was a complete lack of any kind of involvement with elected members in the process. And also that there was allusions in it or references in it to changes to service, reductions of service, that had not been discussed with anybody. And that seriously undermined trust that we have in the process. At that time, we did get an assurance, an absolute rock solid assurance, that no single element of any change would be implemented until it had been brought to this committee in advance for scrutiny. Now, we've had instances, and a lot of instances in the last year, where we've become aware of changes after the event. And so, again, there's some work yet to do to build up that level of trust that you're aspiring to at this time. From an elected member's point of view, Wirral, our main concern is always going to be how the changes that come about an impact on our residents. And we've got some evidence because we obviously do go and talk to people, providers of health, receivers of health care, about what's happening at the moment over services. And I've got some services that I would like to just highlight as being areas of concern. One is the change to the phlebotomy service, which was previously commissioned, I think, through GPs, and is now being done by Royal Community Trust. That we are hearing that there's long distances to travel to access that service. There are long waits for blood tests to be done. And that when they actually get to the place where the bloods can be taken, there's up to 3 hour waits for that. So that, to me, represents a significant deterioration in service. Something similar with ultrasound, where it was commissioned locally, close to home, in the place where people live, and could be carried out in 2 weeks and therefore help with diagnostic availability. It's now up to about 3 months for a wait, and they're being done through our park and not being allocated out. That, I would have thought, was slightly contrary to the premise that we're moving services out of the hospital and into the community. It seems that the services are being actually pushed into the community. Same again with musculoskeletal services. They're being triaged by a consultant, as I understand, and that's limiting the availability of that service. And physio is being delayed by 6 weeks, so that people can have what I suppose might be called opportunity to self-help, and might be given leaflets and being encouraged to undertake techniques on their own accord. all this, and also when we've gone to mental health, where there's up to 12 months waiting for basic counselling services. So that, to me, is not representing a service for our residents that we would like to see. So I'm interested to know, first of all, you've made no reference actually to your presentation to finance. I'm interested to know what the financial implications of your plans are, how they will impact, and most of all, what services are going to be available where in place-based care, where are they going to be as local as they need to be? Because the feeling I can tell you is that they are being pushed into some very big centres and away from the smaller practices of GPs. So there's a lot of points in there, but the overall point is I'm making is we want to see an improvement of service. We want to know what the resources are going to be. We want to know where the services are going to be allocated. We want to know that when we talk about place-based care and services delivered in a way that makes it easier for people to access them, but that doesn't mean to the great big centres.
Councillor, thank you. Forgive me if I missed things that you would like to respond to. First of all, apologies again for not meeting your expectations about the document. We are all happy to provide it and come back again and chair as and when you would wish it. So apologies for that. I think coming back into Mel's point here about what is the role of the STP. The STP is to do two things. One is...
I'm sorry, I don't mean to interrupt you. I don't want to be rude, certainly. We don't actually have an STP for Wirral. You will remember that the Wirral Council didn't accept this. So there was one in existence.
Okay. As far as the government is concerned, they have directed a number of strategic and transformation partnerships, of which Cheshire Merseyside is one. I accept the fact that that word is toxic. I accept the fact that it did not go well in the first round, and we have done a lot of things over the last 6 months to try and rectify that. So I apologise about the term. What the Cheshire and Merseyside partnership is about is two things. Where it makes sense to do things at scale, and there are things that are better done at scale, as Mel outlined in the presentation, then they should be done on a broader level. The second role of the partnership is to provide some degree of system management so that there is we can resolve conflict between areas, between providers, look to where we need to look at services in a wider patch than just a single place. The bulk of the services that are provided to your local communities should be done at place level. And our focus has been, over the last 6 months, to reset the work of the partnership to say, we should be designing services at local community level, and we made the decision, in conjunction with discussions with local authority officers, that we should base those places around local authority boundaries. The services then that are provided within those boundaries, in those borough boundaries, should be designed by you and in conjunction with NHS colleagues, local authority colleagues, third sector. We are bound by the same rules as everyone else is, in the sense that we all wish we had considerable more money. We have to live, we do not have a choice, we're given a job, we have to live within the finance that we are given. But those funds are for you to decide, collectively with NHS colleagues and others, how that money is spent. And so our aim as part of the STP is enabling and providing as much support as we can